So in the last class, we were talking about the implementations of multi-input logic gates, right? More complex logic gates rather than the CMOS inverter alone. The CMOS inverter is single input, single output. What we looked at was something like the NAND gate or the NOR gate, and essentially how we can implement it, first of all, in terms of CMOS, and secondly, how would you choose the sizes of the transistors for the implementation of such a gate, okay? Now, the next question that comes up is, how would we, or rather, what is the impact of these size choices on the delay through such a more complex combinational gate, okay? So that is something that we'll be getting to. Before that, I'm going to digress slightly and briefly discuss how you would talk about, or rather how we would look at the layout of logic gates, okay? So now, when we started off the discussion of the transistor, we essentially looked at the cross section of the transistor, and there we saw that there are a few things that come up over there. One of them is the substrate for an NMOS transistor is p-type, okay? The source and drain regions are N plus. Then there is an insulating oxide over here and a conducting material on top of that which forms the gate. Right? So this was the schematic that I used. Now this is fine as far as the analysis of the transistor is concerned in order to find out how the current flows through it. But what we are ultimately interested in it, what does it look like when seen in three dimensions? And more importantly, what information should I as a designer give to the process engineer so that they can actually build this? Okay. So as for the first question, which is how does it look in three dimensions? If I increase this cross section and sort of look at it in the third dimension, this is something what it would look like, right? This is essentially showing that it goes in up to some distance. This distance that we have over here is essentially the width of the transistor. This dimension is the length of the transistor, the spacing between the source and the drain. In addition to that, we have another length which essentially corresponds to the length of the drain region, okay? Now this by itself has no impact on the functioning of the transistor except for the fact that it adds capacitance. The larger the value of LD, the greater the drain capacitance, which as far as we can see is not good news. We don't want a drain capacitance to be there, so I don't particularly want a large LD. The problem is, why do I even need LD? Because of the fact that I actually need to make a contact. Okay, a so-called ohmic contact where I actually form a conducting contact between the metal which is used for the wire and the N plus region which is the actual drain region. Okay, we have to sort of transition between two different kinds of materials over here, so we need a specific type of interface which is a contact, and building a good contact essentially occupies certain amount of area. Okay. So this is what, all these are considerations that you need to take into account when you are actually doing the design, right? Which means that when we are talking about the layout of a transistor, right, it probably makes more sense for us to look at the entire system from above and say how much area or should be occupied by it, how much area should each of these different segments occupy, okay? So once we look at it from that point of view, the typical diagram that is used for a transistor is something like this. Okay, where this corresponds to the source, this corresponds to the drain, and this corresponds to the gate. Okay, this is the top view, right? And essentially what we are saying is this region is an N plus region, or rather let me put it in here, this is also an N plus region. The surroundings are p-type substrate, and this hatched region over here is a material known as polysilicon. Okay, so how does this actually get built? In terms of the process, what is actually going to happen is I will create one pattern, one rectangle, which corresponds to that entire S and D area. Okay, I will mark off that rectangle over there. Across that, I will put in the other rectangle, which essentially corresponds to this gate, the polysilicon. Okay, so as a designer, I only need to indicate where those two rectangles are drawn. The process engineer, from that, they will understand that, okay, you want a transistor over here. Underneath the polysilicon, there has to be a thin oxide layer, the gate oxide. Okay, so what will happen is I will first pattern out that source drain region. On top of that, I will put in a mask which essentially indicates where the polysilicon is supposed to be there. I will grow an oxide, okay, or rather I will grow a thin oxide over the entire region, put the polysilicon only where I need the gate, etch away the oxide from everywhere else, right, so that only the oxide which is under the polysilicon will survive, then implant a heavy dose of N plus. The result of that heavy N plus implant is essentially the two region, source and drain, become N plus type, and the polysilicon also gets a lot of these N plus dopants, which essentially makes it a reasonably good conductor, right? Pure polysilicon by itself is not a good conductor, but once it has been doped with the N plus or P plus, whatever it is, it starts to conduct well. Okay, so from a designer's point of view, I only need to draw these two rectangles. The process engineer from that will be able to translate these into masks. Okay, so this process of specifying what are all the rectangles that need to be drawn is essentially what is called layout. Okay, when you are doing analog design, you pretty much do the layout of each individual transistor to complete detail. You know exactly how big or where the transistor is supposed to be. You need to specify the regions of the source, drain, gate for every transistor. For digital design, usually we try to club these together. We say, okay, one person sits and optimizes a design for one particular gate, and then I will just repeat that gate many times. Anytime I need an inverter, I will just use that prefabricated layout. Okay, alright, so this is what a single NMOS transistor looks like. Okay, what would a PMOS transistor look like? What do you think a PMOS transistor should look like? Right, you pretty much need to have, first of all, an N substrate. Okay, now the problem is typically the wafer, you can't take two different wafers for this. I can't say that I'll take one wafer for all my NMOS transistors, another one for the PMOS transistors. They both have to be on the same silicon substrate. So what do you do? One way of doing it is to create a so-called N well. Okay, you create a well which is made N type. The P type substrate is doped with enough dopants, N-type dopants, to make it N-type, but not N-plus. Okay? So, very often when you are drawing, not very often, mostly when you are drawing PMOS transistors, you need to sort of specify the N-well region around it as well. Okay? On top of that, I will specify once again these two rectangles. Now this will be P plus, this will be P plus, and this will once again be polysilicon. This is a PMOS transistor. Okay. So, as one of the assignments that we will take up in later, we will actually be looking at a tool that allows you to draw these rectangles, which actually allows you to do the layout. Okay. We will be using an open source tool called Magic, which essentially allows you to directly specify the sizes and positions of these rectangles and the connectivity between them, as a result of which you can actually get all the transistors laid out on silicon. Okay. Now, as far as the final design is concerned, as a digital IC designer, what you do is you go and create all of these. You start off with the logic that you want to implement. You convert it into a set of gates. You figure out how each of those gates is to be implemented in terms of transistors. You figure out how each of those transistors is to be implemented on silicon in terms of the layout. And the information you need to send to the fabrication foundry is just the positions of these rectangles. Okay? It is usually finally clubbed together into a format which is called the GDS2 format. I forget what the term GDS exactly stands for. It's, I think, graphic description stream or something like that. Essentially, it's very clear that it's meant more as a description of the graphical layout rather than the functionality. It talks mostly about where the rectangles should be placed. It does not, and of the material, right? But it does not talk about whether you want an NMOS or a PMOS or something else over here. That information can be sort of extracted from the layout that you have got. Okay? So this GDS2, the layout, is what you finally send to the fabrication foundry. But as far as they are concerned, it's just a set of rectangles which they use in order to create masks and decide how the process should proceed. When should you put the oxide layer? When should you put the polysilicon? When should you put the N plus? When should you put the metal contacts, the metal layers, all of those, one after the other. Okay. So now with this information, the question is, what would the layout of a CMOS inverter look like? Okay. To understand that, we need to continue with this, right? How do we sort of build this into a larger circuit? The first thing that we will need is, we will need supply rails. For VDD and ground. Okay? As far as the layout is concerned, these are just metal wires. Okay? What will be the thickness of the metal wires, or rather the width of the metal wires, that will be decided by a number of factors. The minimum width will be given by some technology parameter. It will probably be 2 lambda or something like that. Right? But do you really want the supplies to be of minimum width? Maybe not, because you typically have a large amount of current flowing through the supply rails, and many such gates will be connected to the same supply. So you don't want its resistance to be large. So it's likely that you might use a thickness for the supply rail which is greater than minimum size. Okay. How long is it supposed to be? That depends on how big your circuit is. Okay. Remember what I said about standard cell design the other day. What you end up with is long VDD and ground lines forming channels, and in those channels you essentially place each of these layouts corresponding to gates. Okay. Now, between these two, I need to have a PMOS transistor and an NMOS transistor, and some way by which they are connected together and to finally get the output. Okay? So let's start with a PMOS transistor. Okay? How much should this dimension be, the one that I just marked over there? Huh? 8 lambda. This is the WP, right? The width of the PMOS transistor, right? So this is going to be WP. Okay? Similarly, what I will do is, just to keep things simple, I will directly draw the NMOS also below that, where this will now be WN. Okay, remember 8 lambda and 4 lambda are what we chose as minimum size transistors. In practice, when you are designing an inverter, you may choose considerably larger sizes for even your basic reference inverter. Okay, now yeah, correct. So I'm ignoring that, right? So that's an important point is mentioned over there. You need to create the N well for the PMOS transistor, right? You actually need to mark off that thing, but because that will sort of clutter the diagram a little bit, I have not drawn it over here. But when you are doing it in MAGIC, yes, you do need to specify an N well. Okay? Now there will be design rules which say how big an N well can be, or rather how close it can be to other types of contacts and so on, right? When you have an N well, how close can your NMOS transistor be to that N-well? Because think about it, what you are going to do is, okay, let me see if I can just create this. The N-well will look something like this. Okay, it will be that region over there, right? Now the problem with that is I have an N-well quite close to that. I am trying to create an NMOS transistor which has N plus regions. So I will have a problem if they sort of come too close to each other. They could accidentally merge if my drawings are not very accurate. Because of that, I will have a design rule which says N well, N plus for NMOS, they should be at least so much distance apart. Okay? So that kind of information is required. That kind of spacing and, you know, those things need to be taken into account over there. Okay? But what he pointed out is right. I was just sort of taking a shortcut here to avoid cluttering up the diagram, but it needs to be there. The N-well is there. Okay? Alright. Now, one thing that we can see over here is, finally, what do I need to do? I need to connect the gates of the PMOS and NMOS together. Okay? So, rather than having two separate polysilicons, I am just going to merge them together and draw it like this. Okay. In fact, I am going to take another shortcut and say, look, anyway, I need to provide input to this gate from somewhere, right? So let's just take that same polysilicon and extend it out to this side and say that this is my input A. Okay. Note over here the way that I have drawn the polysilicon, it's sort of overlapping with that N region. It doesn't matter. The polysilicon is on one layer, the N region is on another layer. They could overlap over here. There are no problems with that. Right? So what is allowed to overlap? What are the things that are not allowed to overlap? Where are the places where you need to take into account these kind of distances and so on? That is what is captured by the design rules of a process. Okay? Now when you use a MAGIC, the layout editor like MAGIC, or there are even more advanced editors available now, right? That already has the information about the design rules packaged into it. Which means that the moment you violate a design rule, it will show you in some way that there's a problem here. And you can fix that. Okay? Alright. Now, what else needs to be done? I have taken the gates of the two transistors, PMOS and NMOS, and I have connected them together. Okay? What about the drains and sources? The two drains need to be connected together, okay? Which means that I need to have some way of connecting these two together, right? And in fact, that is precisely what is done. Usually what I'll use is I'll use a metal layer for this, right? But this metal layer, in order to form a contact, needs to occupy a certain amount of space, and on this side as well. Okay, so effectively what I have over here is, this is a contact, this is another contact, and this is metal. Okay, the metal wires themselves are usually available in multiple layers. I would have 6 to 10 or possibly even more layers of metal available depending on my process. Okay. Usually what is done is the VDD and ground are run on certain metal layer. The routing between inside a cell is run on some other layers. typically what I do is horizontal wires on one layer, vertical wires on another layer, so that they don't intersect. Right? I can then go further than that and essentially take it forward and say I will have another layer for routing between cells. And if you have even more layers, then that gives you additional freedom. Okay? Right now, as far as we are concerned, I need at least one layer in order to connect these two together. Okay? So the drains are now connected together. That same connection can also be taken out this side. Same metal can be extended out on this side as the output Y. Okay? I'm almost done with the layout of the inverter. All that remains is what? The source terminals, right? Once again, same story. This VDD was already metal, so I could potentially just have the metal extending out into the source region, or I might go to a different layer and take it from there, right? So that I have the connections all made at the same layer. That doesn't really matter. That's up to you. It's a choice that you can make, right? As far as we are concerned, we just need to indicate that there's a connection between VDD and ground, rather VDD and the source of the PMOS. Okay. Similarly, VDD and source of, or the ground and source of the NMOS. Right? In all cases, that contact has to be a proper contact, which means that it will occupy a certain amount of area. And from that, you can sort of guess, you know, there must be some design rules on the contact, which is what determines your LD, the size of the drain area and the source area. Okay? If I did not have a minimum requirement on the size of the contact, then I could have made that source and drain as small as possible and reduced my parasitics. But I can't do that. Therefore, I end up incurring that penalty. Okay? So, this is what the final layout for a CMOS inverter will look like. Okay? At first glance, it looks almost nothing like what we draw as the schematic, right? This is what we would normally draw as the schematic. Okay. Apart from the fact that we have put the PMOS on top and the NMOS below, it's not very easy to recognize that this is a PMOS and this is an NMOS. Okay, but that's precisely what it is actually over here, right? So all of these other specifications, right? So for example, this distance that I have over here is LD, drain length. This distance is of course WP, WN, right? There will be some specifications on how much this distance is supposed to be. What is the minimum distance between these two regions, right? All of those things will be captured in the design rules. You need to make sure those are satisfied before you can get a valid layout, right? But once you have that, this will effectively behave like a CMOS inverter, okay? And finally, how big does it need to be, or rather how long does it need to be in the horizontal direction? That's essentially determined by how long your LD is going to be, the contacts and so on, right? There is some scope for optimization over there. You can try and minimize these and reduce those things in certain ways. Up to a point, that is where your ingenuity as a designer comes into it, right? You can actually make decisions which would reduce that with by a certain amount. Most of the time what people do is it's a trade-off. If I reduce that too much and optimize it too much, I might find that actually it makes my layout or combining it with other cells more difficult. Instead, if I can make some simplifying assumptions over there and say I will make sure that my outputs are always going to come out here, my inputs are going to be like this, that could potentially have an impact on how easy is it to use this inverter in an actual practical scenario. Okay, so most of the time, rather than trying to over optimize the layout over here, people instead opt to satisfy other constraints, like how do I make it easier to use and route this system. Okay, alright, so what we'll do is we'll also quickly look at what the layout for a NAND gate would look like before going into the analysis of the actual capacitances and the delay through a NAND gate. Okay, so what's a NAND gate? First, let's look at the transistor level schematic. This is a diagram that I need to implement. Okay, sizes of transistors, all 2. Okay, so now there are 2 things I need to take care of. One is how should the rectangles be drawn and how should they be connected. The second is how wide should they be and where exactly should they be placed. Okay, so to answer the first question, which is how should they be connected, we make use of something called stick diagrams, right? In the stick diagram, I don't worry about the width of the transistor. I only care about the connectivity. Okay, so a stick diagram would look something like this. I would have a stick for VDD, another one for ground. Okay. Now, in between that, I know that I have 2 PMOS transistors and 2 NMOS transistors. Okay. Even though the NMOS transistors, for example, are stacked one above the other, if I sort of try to stack them over here, what will happen is I will need to increase my height of my cell. I will need to change the spacing between VDD and ground. And I don't want to do that if possible. Okay. So rather than putting the NMOS transistors one on top of the other, I'll put them side by side. Okay. So what I'm going to do is just draw 4 regions over here. This is one PMOS, this is another PMOS, this is one NMOS, this is another NMOS. Okay. And now let's look at all the connections that I need. One thing that I can say is one of the NMOS needs to get connected to ground. The drain of that NMOS, where does it need to go? To the source of the other NMOS, not to ground. Okay, so I need one connection here. What about the drain of that one? It needs to go to the drains of both the PMOSs. Okay. So one way of doing it is to say that I'll make this connection here that takes care of one PMOS. Okay. Before seeing where to connect to the other PMOS, let's just look at what to do with the PMOSs. Right? As far as the PMOSs are concerned, the PMOS on the right, I have connected its drain. Where does its source need to go? To VDD. So it goes here. The other PMOS source needs to go to VDD, drain needs to get connected here. Okay. So this diagram has essentially told us all that we need to know in terms of the connectivity that is required. Right? In addition, I need to of course specify the gates. Right? What do I do as far as the gates are concerned? I could just use polys running top to bottom. Okay, so I could use one poly like this. This would be input A. Another poly running like this would be input B. Okay. Note over here that as far as this one is concerned, right, the PMOS on the left side or even the one on the right side, the source and the brain are symmetric. I could have chosen to connect it the other way as well, right? So I could have sort of simplified things and said, you know, both the VDDs are sort of together. I could have even combined both the brain regions together, or both the brain regions for the PMOSes together, and had one connection to VDD. Okay, the source of course would have had a slightly longer wire then. That's all. Sorry, the sources could have been combined together and connected to VDD. The brain would have had a slightly longer wire then. Okay, so keep that in mind. As far as the layout is concerned, it doesn't care which one is brain and which one is source. They are perfectly symmetric from this point of view. Okay, so what would the final layout actually look like? That would be something like this. Once again, I would have VDD. I would have ground. Now I need to worry about the actual widths of the transistors. So anyway, in this case, they are all 2. So let's do that shortcut that we talked about just now, right? So what have I done? I sort of took a slight shortcut over here. I said that as far as the NMOS are concerned, I will not draw 2 separate NMOSes and connect them with a metal. I will just combine them together into one continuous N plus region. As far as the PMOS are concerned, once again, I will not draw 2 separate PMOS. I will combine them into one region. Okay? What's the advantage of doing this? The size that I can use for that shared region can be less than the size that I would need for 2 separate regions, because I only need to put one contact over there. In the case of the NMOS, I don't even need to put a contact. For the PMOS, I need to put only one contact. Okay? So the area that I require for this is going to be less than if I had drawn it explicitly and put in a metal wire joining those two. Okay? So this kind of using shared diffusion regions is quite common in layout. Okay, and while you are actually doing the layout, you can always look for optimizations of this sort. Okay, how does it work? You can look at it carefully. Essentially, you know, from this circuit, you should be able to extract what the functionality is. How do you go about it? You know that the P plus regions essentially correspond to the PMOS transistors. So you are going to extract the PMOS transistors from there, right? You know that there is one terminal over there that's connected to VDD. That's going to be the source. The other 2 terminals will be the drains, right? So this will essentially translate into something like this. I have VDD. I have one PMOS transistor sitting out here. Another one sitting out here. Okay. Both of those are connected together, their drains are connected together using this metal wire. Okay, as far as the NMOS are concerned, there is one NMOS sitting over here, directly connected to the other NMOS sitting over here. This one's drain is connected like this. These 2 gates are connected, these 2 gates are connected. This one goes to ground. Okay. So this is how you can sort of extract the logical functionality from the layout, or go from the layout, or rather, you know, go from the logical functionality to the layout, or vice versa. Okay. Now, yet another thing is often done in practice. As long as you have transistors that are only of minimum size, or you know, maybe 4 lambda, 8 lambda, something of that sort, you can directly draw the W. There are no issues over there. Right? But what happens if I want an even wider transistor? Something which is more than 8 lambda, or more than 4 lambda or 8 lambda, something like that. Let's say 16 lambda, I want to have that width for a transistor. How would I get that without increasing the spacing between VDD and ground? No. Let's say I want a PMOS of size 16 lambda. Leave aside the NMOS completely. I just say that I want a PMOS of 16 or even 32 lambda, some large size, something which won't fit within this space. Think about it, right? I mean, all that's happening over there is, supposing I have this as my P plus region, and let's say I take a poly and connect it like this, okay? And I take metal and say this is one contact, this is the other, okay? Now what is this? What's the equivalent circuit corresponding to this? This essentially says I have one PMOS transistor like this, another PMOS transistor like this, the gates are connected together, the drains are connected together. Okay. Equivalently, I can draw it as which is essentially the same as one transistor of twice the width, right? How do I get that? The lengths, after all, are determined only by this. The length of the transistor is always determined by how wide is the poly. And I've taken two such transistors and put them in parallel. They are not in series. It's not a stack. It's not like what we did in the case of the NAND gate for the NMOS transistors. I put both of these transistors in parallel. Okay. The result of putting it in parallel is essentially that now it's effectively a single transistor of twice the width. Okay. So if I want larger widths, I will need to use tricks of this sort. It is not possible to take a large transistor and directly put it within that standard cell area. I will need to do other optimizations of this sort in order to get that. Okay. The other thing is, one single transistor of large width also has different sort of behavior from multiple transistors of smaller widths that are stacked in parallel with each other. Right. The reason for that is because of various other sort of edge effects that come into the picture. Right? Which one is better? Do you want to have like multiple parallel transistors, or do you want to have one large transistor? That sort of depends on how your analysis of the entire system is. If you have multiple transistors, it's usually more regular. You can actually say that it's going to scale as n times a single transistor. That one large transistor may not be n times a single transistor because of the other effects that come into the picture. Okay. So anyway, all of these are layout related issues, right? Which we will get into in more detail once we go into the actual assignment involving magic layout, right? For the time being, we need to know this because it has an impact on one particular issue as far as complex gates such as the NAND gate are concerned, right? Which is, I am now trying to find out what are all the parasitic capacitances that are going to affect my gate delay. And in order to understand that a bit better, I need to have some understanding of what the layout is going to look like. Okay? So, first thing is, what I am interested in is this situation. NAND gate driving a capacitive load, right? The conditions are such that the output is going to undergo 0 to 1 transition or a 1 to 0 transition, and I want to find out the rising and falling delays. Okay? We already chose the sizes of the transistor such that the current that can be delivered is going to match the current that would be delivered by the reference CMOS inverter. Right? That's how we chose the 2 or 4 or whatever was the sizes of the transistors that we ended up with. Right? But what does that imply in terms of the actual delay through the gate? That's what we want to see right now. Okay? So in order to understand that, there are two parts to it. One is, what is the capacitance of the input side and what is the parasitic capacitance on the output side, right? So let's once again go back to the schematic of the NAND gate. It will look something like this. What are the sizes that we had? 2, 2, 2 and 2. Okay. So now if C is the capacitance of a minimum size NMOS, right? What is the total input capacitance that I am going to see over here on terminal A? 4C. Right? 2C from the PMOS, 2C from the NMOS. Okay? Remember, C was the capacitance of the minimum size NMOS. That's all. NMOS, PMOS, it doesn't matter. Minimum size transistor. Okay? So, size 2 NMOS or size 2 PMOS are going to have a capacitance of 2C. Of course, there are other, you know, overlap effects and the voltage dependence of the capacitance, all of that. But remember what we said. Finally, I'm just taking an average value. That average value is called C, right? I am labeling it as C and saying this is the input capacitance of a minimum size NMOS transistor. Therefore, at terminal A, the capacitance that the previous stage is going to see is going to be 4C. Okay? Next comes the output. Okay? What is the capacitance that I am going to see as the parasitic capacitance over here? What are all the things that are going to contribute to this parasitic capacitance? What is a parasitic capacitance? It's essentially the total sort of opposition to change in voltage that I'm going to see at that point, right? What are the things connected there? The drain terminals of two PMOS transistors and one NMOS transistor, right? The second NMOS is separated by some distance by one NMOS transistor in the middle, right? So the effective total load, the parasitic load that I am going to see over here is going to be 6 times C, 2C from NMOS, 2 into 2C from PMOS. Now keep in mind, look at our layout, right? This is the terminal I am talking about over here. Okay? What are all the regions that we are talking about as the parasitic capacitance, these three. Okay. So depending on how you do the layout, right, you could potentially have a slightly different effect over there, but in this case it's reasonably clear to see why it should be 2C from each of the PMOS plus 2C from the NMOS for a total of 6C as the parasitic load capacitance there. Right? In addition, there is one more effect which we need to be concerned about, which is this node over here in the middle between the two NMOS. That also corresponds to a capacitance. Okay? How much is that capacitance? We will need to look at this to find out. That essentially corresponds to this region over here. We don't know exactly how big it is because in this case we have done an optimization and shared it between the two NMOS transistors. If I did not share, then it would have been clearly 2C from one NMOS plus 2C from another NMOS, so 4C. But because I share it, I'm going to say that in effect I'm going to just club it together and say, you know, the actual capacitance over there is only 2C. Okay? So, all of this put together essentially shows us what are the capacitances that I need to be concerned about on the input side and the output side of a NAND gate. I can do a similar analysis for NOR, AOI, any more complex gate as well. Okay. The next step that we are going to look at is what impact does this have on the delay through such a gate, and how can I model that in a way which essentially allows me to, you know, easily compute delays through such complex gates. Okay. All right, we'll stop here for now. We'll resume after the quiz on Friday.